Hello? There we go. Yeah, it's just worse quality, but. Well, thank you guys for coming. I don't know why the mic died, but. Do you have your phone? Do you want to use your phone as a backup?
So are you ready, Cody?
Yeah.
So I'll give us sort of the formal land acknowledgement. So maybe should we wait another minute just in case, or?
It's under you, isn't it?
No, that should be good.
Yeah. All right. So, you know, not to add to the stress, but the formality of the presentation. So, Oki, welcome everyone. I'm sure that everyone here knows that, or at least if you've not been here before, we are in the archaeology classroom at the University of Lethbridge, and the University of Lethbridge is in Blackfoot Lands. So our Blackfoot name is Inisgum, meaning sacred buffalo stone, and Inisgum acknowledges that we are in the lands of the Niitsitapi people, and we of course celebrate the Blackfoot peoples that we share this land with. Now this is not only the land of the Blackfoot people, it's also the territory of the Métis Nation, Region 3, and other Indigenous groups. And so we acknowledge those Indigenous populations, and we work with them to try to make this a better place. So archaeology is one of the ways that we do that. Of course, we try to document and we try to work with Indigenous groups to better understand and to honor the rich heritage of the lands that we are on. And Cody's work is on one of these sacred sites, sacred locations. And so he's going to be talking about this project that he's been working on. And of course, this project is in Blackfoot territory. So, thank you very much.
Thank you. Have any of you guys been out to Paradise Canyon? No? Yeah, all you guys I know have. So we went out there for, I think, our third trip?
Fourth.
And when we were out there, we discussed how, at the time, it was believed it was a turtle. But when we were out there going through everything, I noticed right away that there was like a very distinct line that didn't have anything you'd normally see with a turtle effigy. So I decided to approach Sean and look into studying it. And I went back out and I took some aerial photos. Here I compare the originals to mine. So right away, like, you can see the site has changed a lot in that time. There's a more distinct, basically, formation visible now than when they did this in 1999. And you can also see, like, well, it's hard to see, but the scale of where the fence is significantly larger than where they surveyed originally. So the original area was about 279 meters squared, and the area that's fenced in now is roughly 462 meters squared. I did that mainly just to see if there was any part of it that they had missed when they did their original survey, anything that wasn't included, or perhaps if they had, like, accidentally fenced off part of the site or covered it up. But it does look like the site fully was fenced off properly, which was at one point a bit of a concern of mine. While I was trying to line it up, there was some issues there that we'll get to. So to start, I took the photos, I connected them together, and I charted out basically any rock that was clearly defined on the printout. The scale is as accurate as I could possibly get. It was taken by a drone at 90 degrees, and because of the way the metrics work on that, I could be sure that there was no tilt that would throw measurements off. And to scale stuff in the photo, there is a bench that I was directly by that I know the measurements of, thanks to the city of Lethbridge. And so, yeah, that's how I started out. Do you guys have any questions on that? Nope? Okay. So I made basically a map. So it's upside down now, because when I started it, I was going from the bottom to top just to chart it separately from the original data. You can see here, like, I went through each rock's number and correlates to a position on here to just make a general heat map of where defined rocks are that you could see easily defined in the original charting. So for the most part in this, I ignored what I have labeled here as clusters that you couldn't make out were the exact same rocks that they charted in 99. I focused also on rocks that were more than 50% above the surface. I didn't probe at all like they originally did. I just focused on majority above ground. And so this is a sparse point cloud. This is basically those charted rocks put into a 3D render of the shape. This one focused on only rocks that had like clearly good lichen coverage, as well as also being 50% above ground and a good size. So I did this originally just to see if, based on the lichen on them and the size, you could make out a distinct shape that I could relate to any other effigy. The one thing I would like to point out here is you already can tell like there's no circular shape left behind. You get a good defined inner shape, but the circle you normally see with the turtle is not there. So to build on top of the sparse point cloud, because it didn't really give any definitive answers, I made a dense point cloud, which is basically just more data into it. The point with that is basically just to more information, the better. So I labeled them from large to like the tiniest, and that was just to help differentiate visually. So I have that dense point cloud here. So the yellow, the purple, and the black are clusters that have defined edges, but the rocks in them contain various lichen coverage and often are stacked in a way that you would see if as was suggested, that the farmer had been dumping rocks or just tossing rocks on it. So especially in here, you have a nice, I would say like a nice cairn, but if you go up to it and look, you can see that like there's smaller rocks that have fallen through and they slowly disperse to bigger. Any questions on that stuff? No? So I went back out and I basically made sure the measurements and photos I took could line up with the original. And I called Sean, kind of concerned, because there was a pretty significant discrepancy. So here, rocks that are marked in blue have been basically, there's at least a 25 centimeter discrepancy between where they are now and where they were charted originally in 1999. And I met with Sean and was like, that's a pretty significant amount of movement in that time. And she suggested that it could have been due to the original conditions. It was hard to get accurate measurements out there. So these are photos that were taken out there. These ones, I believe, are from 2007. And you can see in 2007, it was almost impossible to see. And so I decided to put that to the test to make sure. So I went back out and, oh, I don't have the picture on here right now. But I went back out and I put two posts in a field nearby. So there's this fence here, just on the other side. There's a part that has similar brush coverage to this, but current. And I accurately staked out 3 meters, and then I tried to run string, and it was almost exactly 25 centimeters out, just from the brush pushing it up. So I think in the original, all their measurements were as accurate as they could be, given the coverage, but there's not significant movement. So to move on from that, I decided I would take other examples of turtle effigies and compare it to the site to see if you could see a comparison in shape. And this one is the one you can get the closest comparison from. So all of these are to scale with the pictures. So you can kind of see, like, you could have the roundness there, but then that's only about like a quarter of the overall photo. So it would be a little weird to just make the turtle in one end and have stuff coming off it just erratically almost. And I also compared to this one, which is a good comparison because you can see the roundness. You can see that it has head, tail, and it has legs that curve outward, which are all things that are very challenging to see in that site. And there's another one, again to scale. You can see your the round shape you'd expect from a turtle is missing. So I met with local Blackfoot elders, Elder Shirley, and I also talked to Blackfoot people at the college and university, a lot of them, too many to like even name. Every time they came over, they would look and talk to me about it. Almost all of them told me the same story, that turtle was a late introduction, something that you can also back up with biological records of the migration of the turtle to Alberta. So I thought that is one thing I'd like to do, to also add on top of the argument that it is not a turtle, is if it is older than like 5,000-ish years ago, you could say pretty definitively it could not be, like, they wouldn't have had that much contact with turtle that they would be building an effigy of it at that point. So they also, the Blackfoot elders and just in general, told me about the salamander. They told me how they, like, it would be more plausible how the cultural significance of it was more. And I thought they shared that with me. That would be a respectful comparison to make for the sake of them. Unfortunately, there isn't a ton of ease of access to the artifacts they told me. They told me that they have a headdress that has a salamander as well as a drum. And I've been working with them to try and get photos of that, but they've had some difficulties getting photos, getting me to be able to get there to get photos. But I did, however, find this one. And it's, you can see, like, right away that the overall shape is more relative to the site. You have, like, a definitive larger to smaller areas that you see, as well as, you know, not a big round shape that's missing. So I treated it the same and put it in the same context as the turtles. So the north is north, scale is scale. And you can see, like, just right away that, like, it could be more plausible to be a salamander than the turtle, just based on the width of the body and the head, which you would have here to here. And I didn't want to do what they did and circle it and call it a turtle without saying, like, there's a reason behind the way I put it. So I lined up the arms with one of the definitive lines you can see. There's two here and here. And you can see in this, you do get a better feel that it could be another animal than a turtle. And I don't want to say definitively, it's a salamander, it's not a turtle, but I do think with this and the slides and the lack of clarity of turtle features, you can make the argument that although it may not be a salamander, it's definitely not a turtle. And I think I have just one more slide that goes over basically, like, if I could go back out there, and I've talked to Chris Hobsonson about this, is I would want to basically LiDAR scan it in one chunk and be able to model it as accurately as possible. Yeah. Any questions?
This might be outside your wheelhouse a little bit, but so those salamander, the effigy you showed, the known salamander effigy, it has what you call little horns on it, and those are like the gill stalks from when it's like metamorphosing and coming, like, they lose those when they become mature. So is, in your discussions with the elders, is there anything about why the salamanders, something about like immature salamanders or mature salamanders or anything like that?
So I didn't have like an actual recording of what they showed me, so I didn't want to reference it and butcher it
right.
at all.
Fair enough.
But they did mention that, like, the story they have behind the salamander is, like, when they were collecting skins from all the animals, the salamander came to offer it, but because it was small, they didn't notice it, and it curled up at the door and cried and made it rain. And I wanted to bring that in because that could be part of why, you know, it's near water, it's at a high point, but I didn't want to do that without proper record of their story. But from what they told me, like, it seemed like the salamander had been there a while, like it waited and waited. So I think if they are representing them with horns, it could possibly be just like a showing of time with them, but I can't say for sure.
Fair enough. I was just curious if they brought up.
Yeah.
If the salamander was mature at the time or not. Don't worry.
Yeah, they said like it was there for a while, so it could be. But any other questions? It can be hard. I won't feel bad.
Do you want to talk a bit more about the significance of the lichen?
Yeah, so I went out there originally intending to take, I can pull up photos in a minute, but I went out there originally planning to do lichenography, but there is such significant coverage on almost every rock, the time I had would not have sufficed for that. But I did note and tell Sean that on these rocks here, so from here to here, and then as well as in the cairn, all have about the same amount of lichen and are all facing the same way. So on all of them, facing towards the water. So if I went back out there and did, like, I would like to do LiDAR and, like, actual scanning of all the data so that it could be taken into account more accurately.
Mm-hmm. And for those that aren't aware,
oh yeah,
why?
So you can use lichen to somewhat age rocks. It grows differently on all of them, but it can help, like, obviously, if you know, none of the rocks have lichen, it's going to be probably a newer site. So the more lichen, the, you know, you can say it's a bit older.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Anything else? Yeah, Matthew.
This might be another out-of-bounds question, but since there's multiple salamander species in Alberta, did the elders you talked to indicate any kind of, like, what species they are?
Yeah, so it was, what's the one that they had forever was it Helen Schuller? Was it the tiger salamander?
That sounds right, yeah.
Yeah, it was that one. It's the one that, it's like the brownish skin with the stripes.
Okay, fair enough, that makes sense.
Matthew, got anything else? Yes.
Yeah, so thanks for the presentation, really interesting. I might have missed this with the technical discussion, but I'm always curious. You're dealing with this kind of effigy, with this kind of work. It's kind of like a Rorschach blot, right?
Yeah.
So you're fitting who you want. So how are you discriminating when you're picking out which ones that you're highlighting with your mapping and which ones you're leaving out?
So to avoid that, that is why I originally treated it just like this. So that was the point in the sparse point cloud. Let's say they had an original feature there. So some Blackfoot people I talked to had suggested nappy, because you, with the sparse cloud, you can see almost what could have been legs. So I did do the sparse point cloud to kind of say, like, you know, I'm not, there's nothing personal about this. I'm only doing ones with, or sorry, there's no interpretation in this. I'm only doing rocks with good lichen coverage and are, you know, clearly in their original and mine. So I tried my best to avoid, like, you know, it is like a Rorschach. You want to see something. So I tried my best to eliminate that, doing the sparse and the dense too. That's why, like, especially with the dense, I treated the clusters as probably a bit larger than they are, because, you know, if you go into the cluster, they're all tiny little dots. I could have just, you know, circled here and here and been like, there's the salamander. So I tried to keep it as, you know, unbiased as popular, and that is why, too, like, I don't want to say it with certainty it is a salamander. I felt like putting that in, I could be, you know, respectful to what the elders told me, but I do want to say, like, I'm certain it is not intended to be a turtle. That answer your question?
Yeah, thanks.
Awesome. All right, anything else?
I'll ask you one more. Go ahead, Mavis.
Sorry.
No.
Like, you mentioned about LiDAR. Mm-hmm. Are you thinking of, like, aerial LiDAR or handheld?
Neither.
Oh.
So, there's... So there's a really good fence here that I'm hoping next semester I can go put basically a three-axis system in by hooking up wires to each corner, and then I'll put a central device that can move along the X, Y, and then Z if needed to keep itself level. And I want to scan it like that, all in one chunk. I would like to do, like, aerial would be ideal, but, like, there is, you can see here, a 50K power line. And, like, when I was flying the drone there already, like, I was, like, I think when I looked it up, it was 2.5 meters to the drone, and then if the drone was just within 3 meters of the ground, I had the potential of jumping it. So it was a little hazardous. So I don't know if I'd want to fly that equipment there.
Fair enough.
But I do wanna try and do this method, because I would like to be able to, you know, like, depending on the pole weight, but the machine itself, I estimate, would weigh like 40 to 50 pounds, and you could scale it to most sites. And yeah, anything else? Do you guys think it's a turtle still?
Well, so let's talk about that, because here you have the original map that the ASA did. So how do you account for their mapping, which is clearly like a larger body,
yeah,
than what you have
so
now?
So if you, yeah, I guess I should have covered that. So if you look at theirs, it's hard to see, but only rocks marked with X were entirely above the surface. Rocks that are like outlined in white were, I think, 25% or more above, and rocks in the black were almost entirely covered. And there was believed to have been dumping from the local farmer, which I would not be surprised, especially with the dispersion you see. You see a lot of like large with smaller falling in, like you'd get from dumping a wheelbarrow here and there, or even just truckloads. But they also like probed, like they stabbed at the ground and called that too. So I think they very accurately, for like this, took it, but they treated everything as 100% equal and didn't try to discern in between a lot of things, because they couldn't see, like they couldn't see the lichen coverage. When I talked to one of the people who was at the site the second time they went in 2007, and he said he had never seen the central portion here, like it was, the coverage was so extreme. So I think, like, I don't think their interpretation was wrong for the data they had, but I think now that there's a more clear area, I think you could open it up to like another interpretation. Anything else?
Matthew?
it can be about anything. No?
Knowing now that all the things that you know, would you do something different if you were to approach the site this time?
Yeah, I think if I were to do it again, I would want to, I don't know if I would use the drone again. I'd want to do like I said, and either LIDAR it entirely so I have every possible piece of data I could, or I would like to do it in chunks, because it's a lot harder to see some of the smaller rocks in perfect detail on like display. So I think I would do LIDAR and look for a higher accuracy of everything. I think that's the only thing I'd change. I think everything else like culminated pretty good, but
let's say that the LIDAR data works really well. How are you going to differentiate between stuff from glacial deposits and purposely placed stones?
So that's why I love LIDAR. So I would be able to basically recreate it at one-to-one, both size-wise, scale-wise, color, and I would just treat everything as data. So I could go through and compare, like, algorithmically every rock to each other. So let's say I go through and there's, you know, let's say like this little cluster here, and maybe this bigger stuff over here is all glacial. And it, you know, start starts checking all the boxes, like they're all similar sterosity or